Are you tired of dieting or pounding the pavement like David Goggins just to shed a few pounds?
You run for hours.
Days.
What? Days?
Imagine a future medicine that could mimic the benefits of literally running for days. Weight loss meds like Ozempic have been sending shockwaves through Hollywood and Wall Street. Advocacy by famous figures went viral on social media, causing supply shortages and more recently, raising questions on their safety. The stonks of select pharma companies exploded, with Danish Novo Nordisk's market capitalization surpassing the country's GDP. Is this first wave of drugs already the be-all, end-all? Well, if you don't want to lose your hard-earned gains and poop your pants, other options should be explored. It's great to have an easy solution for weight loss, but side effects are leading to many users stopping treatment. Meet SLU-PP-332, a simple small molecule melting fat and effectively mimicking marathon training in mice, all without setting a tiny paw on a treadmill and without eating less. We will cover this molecule's discovery, chemical synthesis, and preclinical efficacy. This will enrich your interdisciplinary knowledge and give you some good practice for data interpretation. We'll also explain how the broader class of exercise mimetics work and cover random facts, such as taking a closer look at the alleged health benefits of red wine. Regardless how we feel about it, obesity is the problem for healthcare systems and source of many other diseases. By 2030, nearly half of Americans will be obese, not to mention overweight. Some of you are thinking, why even look at drugs for weight loss? Simply get shredded through hard work. While there is some truth in this, we all know that exercise and diet regimens have very low compliance in reality. People just don't stick to them, even if they know they should. Also, some patients have comorbidities that make them exercise intolerant. It doesn't matter how much you want to be David Goggins, if you have chronic heart failure, you can't run for days. Another issue is the following. The emerging obesity drugs melt away body mass, but much of it is also muscle tissue. So, the quest for drugs which can be used in combination to lose fat, simulate exercise, and retain muscle mass would be helpful for a load of people. Obviously, with hundreds of millions of obese folks, this is a massive long-term opportunity for pharmaceutical companies. This bullish outlook has resulted in a strong investor interest in obesity drug developers, adding billions of dollars to their valuations. The drugs behind this gold rush are called GLP-1 agonists. As mimetics of the incretin hormone GLP-1, they stimulate insulin production and help manage blood sugar. This is especially key for diabetics. They also slow down the movement of food in the stomach, which can help patients feel fuller faster and curb hunger. Leave a comment if you want to learn more about these quite hyped obesity drugs in a future video. They have a massive history of research behind them. Today we will instead check out the so-called exercise mimetics. One of the key links between endurance exercise and physiological adaptation is a so-called peroxisome proliferator activated receptor gamma coactivator 1 alpha. Expressed in various tissues, this is the master regulator of the creation of mitochondria, also known as the powerhouse of the cell, as well as other processes like glucose and lipid metabolism. Because it's a co-activator, it interacts with other transcription factors to modulate the expression of certain genes. Looking at the example of detoxification of reactive oxygen species, or ROS, we realize this gets into complex cellular biology territory. Due to this complexity, dysregulation or malfunctioning of PGC1-alpha can really wreck physiological processes and is connected to many diseases. Why is this relevant for exercise mimetics? Well, you can see here that while various mimetics are known to have different primary targets, most ultimately trace back to PGC1-alpha. One rather famous molecule in this class is resveratrol. This polyphenol can be found in many foods and wines, and it seems like it can trigger just about every effect under the sun. It likely indirectly activates the so-called SIRT1 protein, which in turn deacetylates PGC1-alpha and ramps up beneficial activities. There's a lot of literature on this if you want to check out more of the cellular biology. Some of the first resveratrol insights came from a 2006 study looking at the daily intake in mice being fed a high-fat diet. If you are good at playing spot the difference, you will notice that fat and muscle tissues feature much denser mitochondria. It looks like these mice adapted to exercise they didn't even perform. Thus, we're calling such effects mimicry. We'll cover more mimicry in a moment, but I was shocked to read that some human studies showed resveratrol actually blunted some aspects of training adaptation. Ironically, removal of reactive oxygen species by resveratrol might limit the body's response and thus training-induced benefits. This once more highlights that in biology, nothing is simple or black or white. Based on the immature human data, the verdict on resveratrol is still open. If you check Wikipedia, you can see that basically no clear evidence of any health benefits have been demonstrated, even though it has been investigated for a bazillion different properties already. As a novel class of compounds, such lacking clinical data is a common theme for exercise mimetics in general. Even big pharma companies dabbled in this space, with GSK paying $700 million for a biotech working on a resveratrol formulation around 15 years ago. They didn't test this in obesity, but rather hematological cancers. This proved to be bad luck, as they killed the program after seeing increased risks of kidney failure. You can see that even introducing seemingly healthy substances like resveratrol into medical practice can be challenging. Before we get into the meat of this video, I just wanted to give a shout out to my awesome Patreon and YouTube members. Thanks so much for supporting this channel. Knowing that some nice lads are supporting my ramblings and coffee addiction gives me really a lot of motivation. So let's get into exercise mimetics more deeply. To understand SLU-PP332, we need to take a look at another investigational compound. Unlike resveratrol, which targeted SIRT1, this one activates the estrogen-related receptor gamma. This is one of three siblings of the ERR family, expressed in tissues with high energy demands. These nuclear receptors have received considerable attention for their potential value in treating metabolic diseases. As a side note, nuclear receptors are proteins chilling in the cytosol or nucleus. They can sense specific ligand molecules and in turn regulate the expression of specific genes. As their name suggests, ERRs are structurally related to ERs or estrogen receptors. These nuclear receptors are much better elucidated, operating with estrogens as ligands. These receptors are implicated in breast and other cancer types and accordingly are also targets of some well-known drugs. One of them is Nolvadex, a breast cancer drug more famously used by bodybuilders to manage their gynecomastia. Back to ERRs, which despite their resemblance work via different mechanisms than ERs. The first small molecule ERR agonists were developed by GSK already in the early 2000s. Remember for later that this hydrazone-based agent strongly activates beta and gamma, but not the alpha ERR isoform. Because ERR beta is not very abundant in skeletal muscle, it's suggested that this is a negligible player. ERR gamma is highly expressed in oxidative slow twitch muscle tissues in the calves, with minimal expression in quadriceps, which appear more white. Its powerful effects can be clearly seen if a spooky experiment is performed, creating transgenic mice that express ERR gamma more broadly. These super mice have deep red muscle bellies due to improved oxidative capacity, increased vascularization, and bigger mitochondria. You can see in this endurance exhaustion test that transgenic mice ran roughly 1,500 meters instead of the measly 600 meters from wild-type mice. This means without any specific training, ERR overexpression creates endurance monsters that can run more than twice as far. We also need to look at ERR alpha, the receptor which was not significantly activated by the GSK compound. Like the related gamma isoform, it's expressed in skeletal muscle and has similar functions. We've just seen how transgenic mice expressing ERR gamma are endurance monsters. For ERR alpha, scientists also looked at the opposite model, so-called knockout mice lacking this important nuclear receptor. These mice are able to live somewhat normally, which means that this receptor type is not vital for life. However, if you look at the relative size of the heart and muscles compared to the body weight, the knockout mice in blue have significantly lower muscle mass. As you might expect, this means the mice have a lower endurance capacity and reach exhaustion much faster. The realization here is that if lacking ERR alpha results in endurance weakness, we could be able to mimic endurance exercise by activating it instead with a drug. The first question is, how do we find such an ERR alpha drug? One way is to start with the GSK compound. But wait, didn't we say this one only activated the beta and gamma ERRs? I'll explain. First, you have to note the only available X-ray structure for this molecule is with ERR gamma. This tells us with high certainty what the binding mode might look like. For example, in red, we can see that the phenolic hydrogen is involved in a hydrogen bond with an aspartate residue of ERR gamma. This gamma structure can guide the simulation of how slightly different binding pockets of ERR alpha would bind to 4716. As we've said, the binding is not that strong, but we can still use it as a starting point for the design of more potent drugs. The scientists behind this research identified a crucial phenylalanine at position 328, here in pink, which is present in ERR alpha but not in gamma. By engineering interactions with this unique group, we could design a drug that selectively targets alpha over gamma. This was achieved very easily by converting the isopropyl benzene of 4716 into a naphthalene ring. As you can see from the new simulation, this extended aromatic system can undergo pi-pi stacking with the phenylalanine. This simple change increases affinity for ERR alpha by more than 50-fold. Let's compare it again to ERR gamma. As the phenylalanine is not present, the interactions are weaker here and the agent is around 4:1 selective for the alpha receptor. The chemistry behind this is so easy that it can be managed by even the clumsiest undergrad. The starting materials are simple and cheap. The only thing needed is cooking them up in toluene overnight. The highly nucleophilic hydrazide adds to the electrophilic aldehyde, creating an adduct. After a proton shift, the intermediate can eliminate water, forming the hydrazone linkage of the product. As it precipitates from the toluene solution, it can be easily separated and subsequently recrystallized to give pure SLU PP332. By now you are eager to hear about its effects. Is it really as impressive as the clickbaity title? Let's start from micro effects and go to macro. For some of these, feel free to pause and take more time to digest the info. Upon treatment of isolated myocytes or muscle cells, the researchers observed a doubling of the maximal mitochondrial respiration rate. Obviously, more oxygen means a higher energy production. Not only are the mitochondria more productive, but there are more of them. Notice anything different about these pictures? These are myocytes which have been treated with DMSO control or our molecule, and they have been stained with a rhodamine dye called MitoRed. Our active sample exhibited more red intensities, we can count this numerically, which means that it featured more mitochondria. If you are super clever, you might think that this could be due to the second sample simply having more cells on it, but actually when we count the cell nuclei, these were comparable across both. There were also structural differences. Here you can see stained sections from quadriceps muscles. Notice the difference? There's significantly more green color, which corresponds to myosin protein in type 2A fibers, which are fast aerobic muscles. On the other hand, there are less red type 2B fibers. These are muscles which act fast but use anaerobic metabolism, meaning they fatigue quickly. Interestingly, no difference was observed for slow aerobic type 1 muscle. Knowing this, what do you expect regarding exercise performance? Well, mice treated for a few days with this compound showed superior endurance without any training, being able to run roughly 70% further than normal mice. Unfortunately, the experimental procedure for this assessment is less fun. You can tell because the wording says mice were run. If they subsequently didn't react to electrical shocks, you know that they were legitimately exhausted. There are additional investigations into the why behind this, so specific gene expression targets, but I leave this topic for interested nerds to check out on their own. One interesting finding was that extended dosing for 2 weeks led to a difference in grip strength as well. Unfortunately, the authors don't describe this in more detail. It looks like grip strength decreased over time for both the active and the control group. This might be because of accumulating fatigue or other things. It would be cool if the offers are indeed correct. So if SLU PP332 could enhance some strength endurance and not just pure aerobic performance. We haven't covered one major obvious question yet. The molecule's exercise mimetic effects are very intriguing, but does it have any impact on weight? Well, in another recent study, the team documented that mice treated with the drug used more energy while consuming the same amount of food. Numerically, it looks like they even had less food. Metabolically, 332 triggered a shift towards fat burning. Fatty acid oxidation increased by roughly 25%. On the other hand, the use of carbs decreased. Again, more details can be found in the paper. The magnitude of weight loss depends on the starting point. Normal weight mice with a healthy diet did not lose any weight. On the other hand, obese mice eating an unhealthy high-fat diet saw 12% of weight loss. For just 1 month of treatment, this is not too shabby. The researchers also looked at a genetic model. These mice don't produce the key metabolic hormone leptin, leading to excessive hunger and food intake. Similar to the diet-induced obese mice, these chunky fellas also dropped significant weight. We've noted that providing more than just weight loss is really the next frontier. SLU-PP-352 might be one step in that direction. Of course, more preclinical work is required to understand its long-term effects. Maybe related, optimized molecules could be even more potent. Researchers have not seen any safety signals so far, but tolerability, administration, and translation of effects will be key to be elucidated prior to first-in-human trials. These drugs will not be launched earlier than the end of the 2030s, but with the excitement around obesity, it's definitely going to remain an interesting space. That's it for today. Let me know if you want to learn more about weight loss drugs or suggest any other topics you're interested in. Once again, thanks for watching and supporting my videos. As always, until next time.